Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chris Donovan, Fire Chief with Monrovia Fire Department. I'd like to welcome you to the third public meeting of the Community Wildfire Protection Plan. This evening, we have a full agenda. We will be providing an update on the Madison Fire that occurred last week. Certainly, good timing to have this discussion following that incident. We're going to continue to talk about the Community Wildfire Protection Planning process we're doing in our community. As always, we like to touch on the Ready, Set, Go program to give an educational reminder for our residents. And then we're very fortunate to have a guest speaker who flew in specifically for our meeting, Mr. Pat Durland from Stone Creek Fire, who will talk about tonight's main topic of building sustainability, which is an incredibly important concept as we look to change the approach of fire protection and sustainability of a brush fire, building from the home out. After his presentation, we'll go through and participant input process where we'll talk about strategies for structure hardening. And then certainly, because this is a public meeting, we'll have an opportunity for public comment, and we encourage your thoughts, ideas, and comments as it relates to this process, and then we'll adjourn. You have an opportunity to get some information that's available to you through handout. We have tonight's agenda, the Community Wildfire Protection Plan question and answer comment form. I'll reiterate, as I've done in the last two meetings, we highly encourage you to provide us information, comment, concerns that you have that we can incorporate into our plan and address them appropriately. Either via an opportunity to give oral comment, which we'll take down, or through your comment cards. There's a safe landscaping practices handout, as well as tonight's PowerPoint presentation. So this was not part of our original PowerPoint presentation this evening, the Madison Fire, but we felt it was important to include this as part of the update to this meeting. For most of you in this room, in these chambers, I'm sure you're aware that Monrovia had a significant incident on Saturday, September 20th at 11:05 a.m. We had a 911 call of a brush fire located on Madison Drive. After initial response, which included five fire engines and two battalion chiefs, first in engine company reported heavy smoke and about a half of acre of brush fire burning uphill rapidly, and immediately called for additional resources. This fire was a fuel and topography driven fire. The third element that's a concern for us is wind, and we were very fortunate that we did not have windy conditions, the Santa Ana conditions that are typical. In fact, if you look at the news media, there's a forecast for Santa Ana's that will be starting on Wednesday through Friday. If that fire had occurred during the Santa Ana condition, I think we would have had a completely different outcome. But what we ended up with was 125 acres of very thick, dry brush that hadn't burned in over 55 years that created a pretty fast-moving, very hot fire that consumed a good majority of the brush in that area, almost down to barren earth. We're very fortunate with the response within the Southern California region that we had no loss of life and no structures were damaged during this fire. We did have one firefighter from a local agency that did have some heat-related injuries, but he was able to recover on scene and actually go back to work. So a little bit more detail of the fire. This is a map from actually the first operational period. The fire again started on Saturday. We didn't have full containment until Thursday afternoon. So this was an extended operation with firefighters assigned 24 hours a day. What this fire map here demonstrates is different lines, and this is what we use to determine containment of the fire, which we report to the community and the media. The black line indicates full containment where hand crews and or bulldozers went through and were able to cut line. The lines with the crosses are that initial lines were cut, but were not cleared up enough to give us a black line. And then the red line is open fire. At this point, we estimated the fire was about 15% contained. This was early on. Below is an aerial picture of the fire and the ridge lines that were primarily involved with the Madison incident. I'd like to go over the resources. Monrovia, as you know, is a small town. We have two fire stations with two fire engines, a truck, a battalion chief, and a paramedic squad. We're able to handle routine fires. We're able to handle routine emergency medical calls in a very fast and efficient way. But occasionally we get large incidences, and this is one of them. And we rely upon our California Master Mutual Aid System. This is the concept of neighbor helping neighbor. So obviously this fire grew beyond our capabilities, and we immediately asked for help. In the end, 57 fire engines from as far away as Santa Barbara and Montecito to Anaheim and Brea, as well as most cities in the Los Angeles region. We had 9 hand crews. These were the crews that were up there with tools and equipment cutting the line. We had mutual aid assistance with bulldozers and overhead personnel that helped with managing the fire. And in the end, over 26,000 feet of hose was deployed around the perimeter of this fire. That was 4 miles of hose was deployed around the perimeter to maintain structural protection. Now, like most fires in this area, air support is a very important component, and we did have availability of resources. We were able to have, at the height of the incident, 5 helicopters from CAL FIRE, which is the state fire agency, the Los Angeles County Fire Department, and Los Angeles City Fire Department. We also had 2 fixed-wing tankers flying out of air bases in Central California, and 1 spotter plane. This is a good picture of one of the tankers dropping FOS check along the ridgeline protecting structures. This next picture shows you graphically the structures that we had immediately threatened. The outline in red is the perimeter of the fire. In purple and the yellow dotted components that you see there is the area, the neighborhoods, and the actual homes that we deemed to be immediately threatened. There were 390 structures that we reported to the state of California that were under immediate threat of this fire. The next slide I'm going to show you indicates why we had to do mass evacuation. We were anticipating that this fire was burning in a northern, northeast direction following the topography and the ridge lines. And we had identified several objectives that were important to hold. One of those objectives is near this water tank off of Highland. And our concerns were that if the fire went beyond the water tanks, our next neighborhoods of high concern would have been in the lower clamshell. The inholders would have gone into the Gold Hills homes and perhaps continued in an easterly direction. So in anticipation of that, we called for evacuations. All told, approximately 500 homes were asked to be evacuated at the height of the incident. So, lessons learned here for the fire department. One, quite frankly, the cooperation between the fire department and our residents with the work that we've done through brush abatement, through education, through the hard work and efforts of the Ready, Set, Go program to prepare yourself for the event of a fire, to get set when a fire starts, and to evacuate when we call for the orders, really came to light and ended up being a true benefit in that we did not have to worry about residents staying in place and defending for their lives. Most of the residents understood the importance of evacuation and did so. Granted, this was an inconvenience, but in the end, I'm proud to say that we were able to protect all the homes and not have a life that was lost. This is my concern, however, and I share this with the fire chiefs in Southern California. This is an unprecedented early fire for the season, and that I think given the reports that we're reading based off of the low rainfall, less than 5 inches of rain fell this winter, based off of the fuel moisture accounts that are being pulled right now from experts in the field, we are finding record low fuel moistures, and that's important because the moisture in the fuel dictates how fires burn. And we're in late April, early May, We're seeing temperatures and fuel moisture content that is typical in July and August. So the concern is that we're in for potentially a long fire season here in Monrovia and across Southern California. So that's an update on the Madison Fire. Tonight's program is continuing our CWPP update. And so what I'll do is hand it over to Rachel Wing, who will talk about the CWPP, and then she'll introduce Pat Durland.
Thank you, Chief. That's Community Wildfire Protection Plan, CWPP. And by community, we mean the fire department and the residents. Thank you so much for coming. Also, we have a Fire Chiefs Advisory Group, and a number of members are here tonight. Glory Crudgington is here, Tom Dittmar is here, and Brenda Trainer is here. There's several other members who weren't able to attend, but they've been working with us on this project for a while too. And stakeholders as well. We contacted Fish and Game, CHP, county, a whole lot of stakeholders, and they've also participated. Our advisory group has met since September a number of times. Oops, I meant to do this. And then we've had, this is the third of a series of community meetings that we've held. And some of you have attended those too, and thank you very much. And then we had a stakeholder meeting with those various organizational stakeholders that I mentioned and many more in February. And we are anticipating a series of neighborhood meetings probably in June. So those of you who live in the very high fire hazard severity zone should be receiving a postcard or a letter giving a location and a date for a neighborhood meeting regarding planning for wildfire. So the goals of this plan are, of course, mitigating hazards associated with wildfire. That's number one. As a community, what can we do? What are all the various different actions and strategies we can take? How can we educate ourselves as a community and as individuals? We want to build in environmental sustainability in this, and that goal actually goes hand in hand with the Hillside Wilderness Preserve planning documents, which actually did call for the preparation of a CWPP. And so we're trying to mesh those two goals of environmental sustainability and safety. And then there's other reasons why a community does a CWPP, and that is the Federal Healthy Forest Restoration Act established certain benefits, greater eligibility for certain federal grant funds, the opportunity for a community to self-describe its own wildland urban interface, what we think that area is, rather than just taking whatever the state and the feds designate that to be. And in order to meet those requirements of a CWPP, it needs to include prioritized fuel treatments, which are basically reduction of fuels. It has to address structural ignitability, which our guest speaker tonight is specializing in, and we're going to really focus on that, how to harden our homes so that they can resist so they can be resilient to a wildfire. Basically, a wildfire can occur in the community and involve no loss of structures, which is what happened in this case. And it has to be a collaborative process. So our to-do list for this, we needed to evaluate what the risks and hazards associated with wildfire and designate a project area, which has been done, and there are maps that we've defined the very high fire hazard zone. We've defined an ember protection zone, which is a little downhill, basically, from the high fire hazard zone, but where people need to be aware of the hazard of embers landing on their structures. And also just an area where, if there was an evacuation, would be involved in that, a safety zone. we're doing ongoing public education and outreach. We've got the maps finished, and we're developing best management practices for vegetation management, and also for home hardening. And those will be individual chapters in the CWPP. And our action plan, we in addition to all those best management practices, we need some action items that we can act on. And at the end of this process, we hope to have a list of prioritized actions to take to City Council and say, this is what could be done, this is the associated cost, and this is how the community assesses the priority of that. And tonight we're going to focus on hardening homes. How you can contribute, there are many formats, coming to meetings like this, participating. There's a comment form, I think it's in green, that in your handout packets. You can email us, and there's email addresses on, I think, the green form as well. Please educate yourself about wildfire and wildfire hazards. There's a CWPP website that you can link to from the city website that links to, there's a wealth of educational material about wildfire. And you can recommend projects like we're going to do tonight. And please stay involved, follow the website. Get on the notification list if you would like to be notified. Just put your email address on that tonight sign-up list. So I also want to talk about the Monrovia Ready, Set, Go program that the chief alluded to. It's an important concept that was actually followed during this fire, and we're developing it further. There's a lot of support for it. We have our community emergency response team that is a big part of both Ready and Set. And we've gotten some grants from the Fire Safe Council, a grant currently that is helping support the outreach for Ready, Set, Go. These are illustrations of how defensible space around homes is effective. And this one is, I'm afraid I forget what fire it is, but you can see there was fire all around a neighborhood, and the structures inside it did not burn, and that's what we want. The other two are Monrovia properties that exhibit very good defensible space. This is a home with a native garden, native plant garden, and it's kept very, very lean, very clean, very healthy, and they've really done everything that you could do for defensible space. And this is just an illustration of how a native plant, I think it's an oak, on a hillside can be retained. When we talk about brush clearance, we're not talking about moonscaping. We're talking about removing fire ladders and reducing fuel loading altogether. And so this dry grass is kept very short. If it should burn, there's nothing to carry a fire up into the canopy of this tree because it's been trimmed up. So those are good components of defensible space. The Ready, Set, Go program includes, actually has a checklist for preparing. The defensible space is an important part of getting ready. Home hardening is a very good example of getting ready. Even figuring out what you're gonna pack, making your family's plan for evacuation, that's part of ready. You could do tonight. When you start doing tonight, long before any fires around. So these checklists are for that. Here we've got somebody cleaning out their gutter, neighbors talking about their neighborhood safety. Those are all part of ready, just preparing. Set is when you become aware that there are wildfires or potential for wildfires in the area. So you really sort of get your plan ready to go. There's our CERT team getting ready for that. And then go, we want people to leave early, get their pets out safely, have a plan in advance for getting their pets out and their important documents. We're going to talk a lot about what a hardened home is. Ember awareness is a really important part of it. Embers can fly a long way from the fire front. so it's not just the flames that threaten you. We want to be aware of roof, eaves, vent, walls, windows, doors, balconies, and decks, and Pat will talk a lot about those tonight. And so I'm really pleased to introduce our speaker, Pat Durland. He came to us from Idaho. Today, he's the principal of Stone Creek Fire, Inc., which is a wildfire consulting company. He has decades of, and that's a good thing, of wildfire experience, both fighting fires on the fire line and also doing hazard mitigation and planning and education. He's been really involved with the NFPA, the National Fire Protection Association. Actually, I've taken courses from him. They write very detailed standards on all kinds of things, not just wildland fire, but building structures. But these are very well-researched standards that various jurisdictions actually apply. And he does the training for the wildland fire home mitigation one, and has done a lot of training around here. He was just recently in Duarte giving a day-long workshop on that to various fire safe councils and individuals. And we are very happy to have him here tonight. Thank you very much, Pat.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, everybody. How's it going?
Good.
It's good to be here. I want to thank in advance, because I usually forget, okay? At the end, I want to thank in advance the chief, Fire Marshal Haverly, Rachel, and the CERT team, and everybody for having me. I always enjoy coming down here and sharing information with folks, because there's a lot of misinformation. We're going to talk about some of that on this subject, and we need, you know, before we can make good decisions, before we can find solutions to this problem, we need to be going with good information. So that's what we're here to do tonight. And the other thing Rachel didn't mention to you is along with decades of experience, I've got 2 decades of being a resident of the wildland urban interface in Boise, Idaho. And prior to that, I was a wildland firefighter for years, the first national prevention and urban interface program lead for the Department of Interior, and I thought I knew about this problem. And what I found out is, until I moved into the urban interface, I didn't totally get it. And I truly believe that you don't totally get this issue unless you're living with it on a seasonal and a daily basis. So because you couldn't make this stuff up, you know. If you did, nobody would believe you. But anyway, so the wildfire peril is getting worse. And we'll talk about that. The situations are changing. We're seeing more people in these areas. We're seeing regional climate change. We heard the chief talk about what you're going through here. I've just got to say that about this time every year I start paying attention to the news and the predictions and the weather, and Southern California has been mentioned a lot this year. So you're getting an early start, and it may be a long haul. So I'm glad you're here. And I'm not so sure this is true in this part of the country, but in a lot of parts of the country, we're seeing budget cuts affecting a lot of our fire departments, especially small town rural fire departments are actually closing fire stations. We're seeing young people that don't want to become volunteer firefighters. It's a little big commitment. And they just don't, you know, the tradition has been ending, and some of you will see that. You'll see signs in the airport. I see them in Boise that say, you know, become a volunteer firefighter. So they're actively marketing and recruiting new volunteers, because that segment of the profession is dropping off, and that segment of the profession, you know, is supplies 70% or more of the firefighters in the United States. So here's some of the, you know, issues of fuels, and this is in a ponderosa pine type, but you know, here's 80 years, and we see how the fuel type has changed. There's a couple things that have changed here. This is a healthier fuel, ponderosa pine, about 100 trees per acre. When we started putting out wildfires, we allowed a buildup of other species, and excuse me. Normally, where we would expect a natural fire here to burn along the surface, rather low intensity, now a fire in the same area is going to burn very intense, and it's going to reach the canopies, and it's going to take everything. Where a fire in this area, a naturally appropriate fire would burn underneath, would leave the tree canopies there and give you recycle nutrients into the soil, stimulate the growth, and you give you a park-like setting. So now the situation has definitely changed. I've gone back about 10 years and threw these together just the other day. 10 years, let's recap 10 years of large fires. 2003, Cedar Fire, still, I believe, the most destructive fire in California history. 2007, Florida, Georgia, and Utah had historic fires, wildland fires with historic losses. I mean, this has been an issue in the U.S. since the 1800s. The first big fire that we really know when we go back in history is the Pestigo Fire in Wisconsin, where literally thousands of people died. Well, between 1 and 2,000, about 1,300 people perished in that huge fire event over a long period of time. And we've been fighting fires in this country ever since, and now we're breaking modern records here. With all our technology, with everything we know, we're getting our proverbial butts kicked here. It's getting worse instead of better. Again, we have 4 years later, we had more Southern California fires, 120,000 people evacuated. 3 months later, flooding, 16 more people died. North Carolina, a year later, historic fire losses. 2009, more significant fires in Southern California. Jesusita Fire as well. 2010 in Colorado, they set the historic loss record for structures at 169. This was a September fire. And we'll get back to that here in a second. 2011, the Wallow Fire in Arizona, Mastrop County, Texas, 1,600 structures in one fire event. I mean, that was shocking even to me. And it goes on and on. This fire is interesting because in this fire, an individual in my class last month from Canada told me, he said, to stop fires in this community, or excuse me, stop homes from burning in this community, we literally had to take dozers and start knocking down houses, because that was the fuel source. That was our option, because if we didn't, we were going to lose them all. That's a tough decision for anybody in that business to make. This fire in Nevada was in November. This fire in Nevada was in January. These fires were within about 3 months. And we don't usually think of November and January in Nevada as being fire season. One individual on the news said, it's inconceivable that this could happen twice. And I thought, well, that's an interesting statement. It may be inconceivable to you, but for the rest of us, it's pretty obvious that it could happen twice, because it just did. But that's the mindset we're dealing with. We haven't seen this kind of stuff in the past, and we're surprised when we see these events. And that's what I'm trying to kind of get across here. We've got to quit thinking about how these events are are huge, and think about this is the expectation. This may be the new normal. We need to do something about it. So then, about a year and a half after Colorado set the record with historic losses for with the Four Mile Canyon fire, bingo, they beat it by 100 structures. And $31.5 million worth of suppression costs. A week later, they almost hit another 100 structures. You know, within a year and a half, they broke the record three times. This year, Pigeon Forge, Tennessee in March, and Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. You know, who's next? I guess we'll see. How do we fix this? The nice thing about this issue and talking about mitigation is this is the easiest natural peril to protect ourselves from. This is the process of combustion. And it requires heat, fuel, and oxygen. So the things they're doing in this community to reduce the available fuel makes a huge difference. Because when you think about these other perils, these wind-driven perils like hurricanes, tornadoes, you know, the whole community is affected the same way. In a wildland fire, we have the benefit of being able to control the event in a localized area. And we don't have that with hurricanes and tornadoes. So why it's taking us so long? How come we're breaking all these records and we seem so baffled by it? And some of it, you know, we can always pick on our favorites, the media. We get this impression that we are helpless. We are victims. And we see this kind of stuff in the paper all the time. This is the Angora fire. We see people running from the Angora fire. This is an Arizona fire. And this poor grandmother here with her children are just frozen like the deer in the headlights. You know, they should be doing anything but what they're doing right now. I mean, leave, move a wood pile, whatever. And then the next, you know, day we see, well, don't worry. We got a new 747 air tanker. It's going to be cool. So we'll protect you from that. A lot of people don't believe they're at risk. They're in denial because this won't happen to us. I'm not sure if I did anything, it would make a difference. Well, we have insurance. Anybody lost a house here from fire or another event? You know, insurance is designed to help you, but insurance isn't going to get you back 100%. And that's going to take a year or longer to get there. So. Well, we don't have the time, and this is what I think is funny. If you don't have the time to do this, do you have the time, if you lose it, to try and get back to where you are today? Do you have a year? Do you have two? We like to, you know, well, you know, I pay taxes. The firefighters are supposed to take care of this. Well, the planning, you know, folks. And then, of course, there's always the enforcement. And you know, and this is voluntary. Okay, because I know how it works down here, but in Idaho we have a code against murder, killing another human being. But surprising it may seem, some people choose not to comply. You know, compliance is voluntary. Somebody decides they're not going to comply, they don't, and they can have serious consequences, and insurance again. So anyway. This is a dumb problem for us to have in this country. If we were an undeveloped nation, I could understand it. But we have technology, we have the economics, we have the building materials. We know how to fix this. And these people, I don't know where this picture was taken, but these people love their trees so much, they pave around them. But the good news is it's a solvable problem. So in the solutions, we need to think about this process of combustion, because we can't change the path of a tornado, but we can change the path of a wildfire. Because in these severe fires, and we'll talk a little bit more about how severe these fires are getting, our normal protection response is not enough. It's overwhelmed. There's not enough engines for every home. The fuels around homes are so flammable that it's not safe to send people in there. The good news is little things that homeowners do make a huge difference, and that's where we want to start. Don't think of this as a geographical location, because these embers can travel for, depending on the conditions, a mile, 5 miles. So you don't have to be next to the fire. If you have a lot of stuff on your roof, if you have a lot of stuff around your home, and embers start landing on it, you know, you're in the threat zone. It's not your location from a geographical standpoint. It's what looks, you know, what's going to burn around your home if you have an ember shower that day. So we need to do stuff before the event begins. We need to understand what works and what doesn't, because like I said, there's a lot of misinformation. We have science out there, and we have a lot of tribal knowledge, and a lot of the tribal knowledge, to be honest with you, is not accurate anymore. The science has proven it to be, you know, compromised. We need to invest in those actions that are going to make a difference and that reduce these losses, because we want homes to survive these fires like Rachel showed. And we want them to be able to survive on their own without intervention from the fire department. And when I say before the event, this is not what I'm talking about, okay? This was another Angora fire picture, and he's got a wood roof, and he's got to evacuate. Well, he better hit the roof once with some water, you know? That's not going to do it. So if we look at effectiveness and how effective our fire departments are at this point in time on these fire situations, we find some startling statistics. Our suppression response is 98% effective. We catch 98 out of 100 fires in the first couple burning periods. So these mega fires we saw listed here, these historic fires, are 2%. The ones we see on TV are 2% of our fires. They are the fires that are burning outside their normal, you know, average conditions, driven by winds, low humidity, and at that point in time, everybody get out of the way. Because the press is right on this issue, and that is when it's going out. And if you think about that, what do you read? Winds die down, humidities go up, firefighters gain control. That's when we catch those weather-driven fires. Some more good news. Most structures are ignited by small flames and embers, not large flames. And we can handle that. Like I said, this is the easiest natural peril to reduce losses from. So this is a good start. This is one that we can take this one off the books for future generations. You know, we can build communities and subdivisions and homes that survive. And we can build those areas where when there's one of these fires, and it's happened down, and it's happened in Southern California, the direction from the fire department has been stay in place, shelter in place. That's the safest place for you to be. And that's the next chapter here. We're moving a lot of people around in evacuations, and that's a difficult task. Not only logistically, but mentally. And people aren't leaving. And if we could keep them in that place, if that was the safest place for them to be, we all win. So we want to look at the structure, because that's what we're counting here. We're counting homes lost. You know, those three slides of megafires were homes lost. That's what we're worried about. We're worried about life and property. So we want to reduce the structure's ignitability. That's where we're going to start, and we're going to continue on in that flammable vegetation around it. And we're going to fight these things smarter, not harder. So the scientific information is really been helpful, and I'm going to show you some reasons how we can you know, benefit from it. This is hard to see. You'll see a fire researcher here with a plate of glass. This is the visible spectrum. This is the infrared. And let's see if we can get this in. This is a little experiment. Anybody remember years ago we used to advise you to take down your curtains on the inside of your window? Anybody heard that one? You know, I always wondered about that, and I asked some questions, and because when I came to California and worked for 4 years, I said, what's this all about? And they said, well, don't you know that if you have curtains on the back side of your window, the radiant heat is going to ignite those, and you're going to have an internal ignition. And it never really set with me until we have some scientific research now, and what we found out is, no, that's really not the case. And here's a little example of that. Just because we can see this heat and these flames through this glass, we find out by looking at the infrared that the heat is not transmitting through that glass at the rate we might expect. Anybody care to guess what's happening to that heat? Some of it's being absorbed, most of it's being reflected. And one individual, one of my class, a firefighter, said, he said, I have seen curtains scorched on the inside of glass from heat. And I asked him, I said, what was the source of the radiant heat? And he says, well, the house next door was burning. And that makes sense, because you've got an hour or more's worth of radiant heat. And finally, it's reflecting, but pretty soon it's transmitting through that glass, and over time, you're getting some heat inside, you know. Vegetation outside that window is going to burn in less than a minute. You're not going to have that that benefit of time. So I don't know what you guys say. I say leave your curtains up. Think of something else you need before you get out of there. You know, in the old days, we used to put a lot of information out there, and I'm not sure why. At one point, I read a brochure, not from this state, but from another state. They wanted you to do 39 things before you left. I thought, 30, that's two weekends for me. I don't know about the rest of you guys, but I'm not going to have that kind of time. To back my car in the garage, leave the keys in it, release the, you know, the door opener, push all your furniture to the middle of the room, turn all the lights on in the house, close all the doors, turn your outside light on, you know, put a ladder under, I mean, it just goes, like, just get your stuff and get out. Okay. And here's some somebody's windows from Monrovia, right? You recognize those, Rachel? But here we are. So here we are with the window issue. And we go out and we do a hazard assessment 3 years ago. I'm here with a member of your community who was nice enough to invite us into his home and invite people over. We walked around. And on the way out, I said, oh, by the way, those windows are beautiful. And they're single pane. And I see the reaction already. And he, and his knees buckled just about, and he said, oh my gosh. He said, I thought you were going to tell me to get rid of my windows because they're single pane. And the reason they're not an issue is because he doesn't have any fuel near those windows that are going to give him the amount of radiant heat that it would take to crack those. And even if he did, they're small enough and they're in such small casements, a cracked window is not going to pull itself out. So again, it depends. If you're building a new house and you're close to your neighbor, sure, you're going to want, you know, multi-pane windows with some tempered glass in it. But if you're in an area, you know, already that's isolated from other homes, and we've isolated the fuels that are going to provide big flames from near the house, those windows are fine. And that's the beauty of the science we see now. We can go in and craft this, use what we know in the science to deal with those issues. We don't have to tell this guy, you gotta take all those windows out of there and put multi-pane glass in. because that isn't going to happen here. He's going to feel bad about it, but those are some beautiful windows. And they're fine in this case. So some of the case study findings we see, given a non-flammable roof, if embers are going to land on your roof and they're not going to ignite your house, we see high rates of survival, and that's coupled with vegetative clearance around the structure. This is from the Bel Air Brentwood fire. And in Santa Barbara in 1990, the paint fire, the study showed similar results. Non-flammable roof, vegetative clearance, and this is, again, like Rachel said, we're not talking about moonscape here. We're talking about reducing the flammability of plants that are going to bring flames to your doorstep or to your house, or that are going to ignite by embers near your house. So here's what the science has shown us, that your house is vulnerable because of a roof being a receptor to embers and structural openings, venting, that will allow embers to your attic spaces, to your crawl spaces, inside your walls, those kind of things. And we want to keep high-intensity fire, big flames, away. Those high-intensity flames that would provide radiant heat, that would crack windows, single-pane windows, that kind of stuff. And we want to keep low-intensity fire at a distance of 30 feet away. And I'll show you a graphic of this here in a minute. So a new strategy here is to shift the focus a little bit from these, and I'm talking about the severe fires now that are weather-driven, is not so much that we try and contain those. That's the strategies we use for fires like the Madison Fire. But when they're driven by severe conditions, we try to design the community and the structures so we can leave. And when we come back, when the big fire blows through, we come back and the structures are still there. And we can go around the structure and put out the small fires rather than having to put our folks at risk to that high radiant heat from big flames. And that's the fire that our bodies don't tolerate well. So when we do that, we reduce the danger to firefighters and the community. And we reduce the potential for disastrous home losses. So, and here's what I'm talking about. So if we start separating vegetation, so the aerial fuels, the canopy fuels at about 100 feet from the house or 200 feet, we want to see those big flames drop to the ground and become surface fires. We still have trees, we still have clumps of trees, and when that surface fire gets to this 30-foot area, it runs out of fuel, runs into water lawns, plants that won't burn, and then we want to look at the structure and its ability to resist ignition from ember deposition. Is this making sense? Are you still with me? Okay. So here's some of our friends to the south at another county, and we talked about hardening homes. Here's one of those natural areas or preserves or wilderness areas that everybody enjoys, you know, being by. And here are the homes on the edge. And what happens here is these areas will bring fire right to your doorstep, right to your deck through wildland fuels. And so we have a wildland vegetative fire here, and we have fire to structure. And then we have one structure ignite, let's say, maybe it's weakened by non-compliance or vegetation right under the deck or lumber under the deck. You know, I've been guilty of all this stuff too. Okay, so I know how this works. And then it changes. Then we have building to building ignitions, and that's much more serious situation. And then we got one guy here.
Any explanation why it did not burn?
Didn't meet the requirements for combustion.
Sure.
And when I say that, I say that to buy myself time. The question becomes why, and that's the question. And I can't tell you why. I've got a couple ideas here. I think the thing to point out is these homes were probably all similar. You know, from construction time, time they were built, the materials that were used. And so the question even becomes more curious. One situation that individual that was there said, you know, he said, I saw some folks that had stucco fences. Instead of wooden fences, they had stucco fences. And we have a 6-foot high stucco fence on either side of your house. If you have homes burning on the other side, that fence is going to block a lot of radiant heat. That may have been the answer. My understanding is that the fire service was not there. But the other thing you see here, see all the unburned material? We have a lot of vegetation. And when you see these pictures, look at the unburned vegetation. It's everywhere. We are living in homes that are more flammable than the surrounding vegetation. This is a stupid problem for us to have. So here's the home ignition zone is a term we are, you know, the science is evolving. It's a little more definitive maybe than defensible space. There's a lot of questions. Defensible space have been around a long time. People define it different ways. So we started talking about the home ignition zone, and that includes the area, the structure, the area around it, any associated structure, sheds, and the vegetation that could burn. I mean, this guy has vegetation here and he has trees, excuse me, but this is, you know, resistant to ignition. And here's one of the postulates. If it's attached to the house, it's part of the house. We saw several houses today with wooden fences that were either stucco or metal before they met the house. So they're not going to lead fire to that structure, because that's what happens. Everybody evacuates. There's more fire than there are fire personnel. And now we have small fires reaching a fence, igniting a wooden fence. Over time, they travel close to the house, and 4 hours later, you know, we have flames directly on the house. Here's a shot I like, because not only did this home survive in a severe fire, because we can tell what kind of fire behavior we had here, This individual's got some plants there as well. So he's not going to start from zero. And that's what I try and have that conversation with folks when we're talking about what they value around their property. Well, if you do this, you thin out this little group of trees here, not only will you make them healthier and reduce the competition, but you will make them survivable. And if there's a fire here, severe fire, your home will probably survive, as well as a lot of your landscaping. And you don't have to start from zero, because some of these trees that are 40, 50, 60, 70 years old can still be there. And you can still have some mature landscaping. So.
In the past hour, but the winds have kind of been picking up in the last few minutes or so, and that's what crews here.
That was me. I hit the wrong button with my thumb.
Past hour, but the winds have kind of been picking up in the last few minutes or so, and that's what crews here are worried about. They've been cutting down trees in this area, hoping it doesn't spread into downtown. Now, that's some of that video that we shot earlier. That's taken actually at Via de Santa Fe and Via de la Valle, where at least 3 homes were on fire. Now, these burning embers just filled the sky. It looked like a rainstorm of fire and ash. And firefighters say the big problem in that area are the palm trees, because, you know, they go up very quickly. The embers spread to other areas, and they say that's how this particular fire started, from flying embers nearby. They have been here all morning long working on kind of these hot spots. Again, they want to prevent it from moving downtown, because there are a lot of old buildings in this area, also a lot of multi-million dollar homes, very expensive area here.
Similar circumstance. Yes, sir.
One comment. That area of San Diego has been carved out of a eucalyptus forest.
Right.
So we're talking about just not palm trees.
True. Another thing about this particular area was, if you noticed, not wind-driven, you know, not a lot of wind there. That was coming down like a, you know, the perfect Christmas snowstorm, right? My understanding is that those embers were caused from one structure and one tree on fire. I also understand there was a pickup load of sack lunches going to firefighters, and the driver turned around looking at his back of the truck, and they were all on fire because they were paper bags. So the good news is they got hot lunch that day. I don't know how you get a fire like that. Now that's a problem, okay, if you're driving that pickup. So here's some of the stuff we see, and this came from another county. This is Orange County's problem, evidently, because that's where I got this photo. But I've seen some of these trees here as well. We see photos like this, too. That's pretty intense. And, you know, look at this dead component here on these trees, and that's serious stuff. I mean, that's not only embers, that's intense flames that you don't, we can't be near those.
Do you need to switch?
No, there's no audio. No audio. So here we have some firefighters deciding to do some point protection around a structure, and what do they find? A broom. So like I said earlier, it's little stuff that we didn't think about before. If we came out and did a hazard assessment of this house, we probably would have been talking about this tree right here. And if that house had burned down, who would have guessed that it would have been a broom, or could have been a broom? So that's the kind of thing. We saw the embers, we saw the video of the embers. Think around your house, and if you're having trouble thinking what you need to worry about, think about it this way. If it was cold and you needed to build a fire, and all you had was this stuff on your roof, or around your house to start this fire with, where would you go? Can you find some needle pine, dried pine needles in your gutter? Can you find some you know, dead leaves around the base of your home? Because that's what the embers are gonna find. And so let's look at the structure. This structure, it's Rancho Bernardo. I had to walk up to this guy and ask him. I said, "Is that real wood? Are those wooden shingles?" And he said two words to me. He said, "Fire treated." Because the interesting thing was the house over here was stucco with a Spanish-style roof and burned to the ground. So again, this guy was paying attention. He had replaced his roof with a non-combustible roof, didn't want it to look like stucco like everybody else, and wanted to update it and keep the look he had for the 30 years he and his wife had lived there. And so they put shingles back on it, but they were fire treated. Here's the Class A roof. We give the maximum amount of points to, but look what we got here. We got our little friend here who's been building nests in these holes for 20, 30 years. And these holes are designed to vent this roof. So on a passive day when there's not much wind, we want to see air going through here, through the attic and up. So you kick in embers and wind, and that's exactly where they're going to go. Now we put a little turbocharger on this, and this house is going to burn from the inside out. Then we put bird stops, but bird stops still here have some openings here. This is more like what we see. It's hard to see in this slide, but there are fire stops here rather than bird stops. And here, they're discrete, but there's actually, an ember-resistant venting system here. That's where the vents are in this roof. This is what happened in a lot of those homes in Rancho Bernardo in 2007. Burned from the inside out. This is the kind of stuff, like I was saying, that the embers are going to get. This is a poly gutter material. So the question here is, what's going to happen when this stuff melts and drops down there? What's below it? Is it patio cushions? Is it a juniper bush? Is it your driveway? Because that's going to affect where this fire goes. And if it goes out, or if it has a potential of lighting something else, it's going to ignite your house. Something as small as this. You know, embers into the vent here is going to put fire into your attic space. Here are some of those little things like we saw in the video. And we're not asking people to deal with this on a daily basis, but, you know, if you're going to be gone for the weekend or gone for 10 days on a vacation, you know, put your patio cushions inside, put your, you know, your floor mats or your cocoa mats, that kind of stuff, somewhere out of range of embers. Here we have pine needle litter. That's going to ignite with embers, or it's going to creep across here. We have firewood and we have stairs. This house looked pretty good from the front. We walked around the back and thought, okay, that's what's going to burn this house down. And I don't know, years ago I've talked to firefighters and on some of these fires, and they said, you know, I must have driven by that house 5 times and it was fine. And then the sixth time I came by it, the whole place was on fire. Well, did you stop and walk around it? Well, no, I didn't think about that, but that's what's happened. Over time, this is going to take your house out. There's nobody there. Here's Bill and Nancy's house again, but embers hit the siding, dropped down here, and went out because there's no fuel there. Anybody use these things? You got these things hanging from your eaves? You know, this will put an ember-ignited flaming fire under your eaves, against your windows. This is juniper. Look at the, you know, this is just naturally, this is what they call a pyrophyte. Pyro meaning fire. This plant is designed to burn. And this is why. All this dead material, a lot of air in there, it drops litter. A lady who lost her home in Rancho Bernardo said, when I left here, all the juniper were on fire. So that's what the embers did. And she was really wrong. Not all the juniper were on fire, because this was the house across the street. Let's see what they did to their juniper. They took out that bottom component. They took all that stuff out from underneath, and the embers didn't have a good place to start. And look how moist this is. So we're not saying that you can't have juniper close to your house, and that's the beauty of the science. We're finding out that even a fairly volatile plant can be trimmed and maintained and kept. If you like juniper, and personally I don't care for them, but we have them because somebody else in our family does care for them. It's a democratic thing, I guess. Here's another way, and this person was, you know, he or she is either really good at this, or somebody that maintains their yard. I mean, look at this stuff, and look what they've done here. They've kept a very volatile plant, and they've made it very ignition resistant with rock, and they've taken out the dead component. So that's the beauty of the information we have now. If you're in love with something or have strong feelings about it, we can make that work in a lot of cases. So, this issue begins with the property owner. If you own the fuel, you own the fire. And now we get to the hard part, okay? We've given you some of the physical science. Now we get to the social science. How do we make this happen? And the social scientists tell us that first people have to understand what we're talking about and why it's important. And they have to accept the fact that, yeah, I like those junipers didn't look that bad. I could do that. But unless the wood pile gets moved or covered, if you don't want to move your wood pile, let's throw a tarp over it. Unless something changes and we act on it, the situation is not affected. So action. And you know, if you've ever had a spouse, you know, children, pets, you know that changing behavior is about the hardest thing there is to do. But you also know that it's worth the effort. And that's what we're talking about here. Yes. And basically, what we're talking about is yard work. We're talking about yard work, cleaning up, you know, the dead litter around your house, on your roof, maybe making some structural improvements on your building. I moved into my house, we had a wooden shingle roof. And I thought, how am I going to get out of this one? Okay, I am the first national prevention person for the Department of Interior, and I'm moving in the interface with a wood shingle roof. And I realized a lot of, that's when my learning curve began. You know, because we were telling, I was telling my folks, well, you need to tell somebody with a wood shingle roof that they're going to die. Not quite that bad, but you know, that they're really at risk. And then I realized, okay, well, there's some economics involved here. Is this going to cost me $10,000 to change this roof, and it's still got 10 years to go. So what am I going to do? So I went and started doing other stuff, and 2 years later, I saved up enough money to do the roof before I needed to. So it's, you know, it's you don't always get to handle the first priority, but there's something you can do on a weekend to make a difference. And this is how Mark Twain said it. You must have some time to mentally process things and to get out and do this. And so here's kind of the structure. I threw this one in because it fits what's happening here in Monrovia. We're starting here with a roof on a single residence. We're looking at the eaves, we're looking at the walls, the decks, and we're looking at that home ignition zone right here on a single structure. And this is the home ignition zone. And this, there's a pro, you know, there's a social model, FireWise communities, there's Ready, Set, Go, there's fire safe councils that deal with this stuff. And then we move up a level to subdivisions. Because a lot of these, not everybody has 100 feet of their own. You know, they've got neighbors on both sides. And if you've done all your work and your neighbors on both sides haven't done it, you're still at risk if you're 12, 15, 20 feet. So it needs to become a subdivision issue, and it needs to become a team kind of thing. And then here we have what Rachel and the chief were talking about. The umbrella of this whole thing is the city-county level. And you folks are lucky because you have a fire department here that sees what the potential is and knows that they've got to deal with that and knows that they need help doing that, that they can't do it by themselves. Because this is a team sport. 98% of the time, they're going to take care of this for you. But it's that 2% of the time when you see conditions that are severe, that everybody needs to have a piece of this, and it needs to be working. So, questions, comments? Yes, sir.
If you're asked to evacuate, is it a good idea to turn your sprinklers on and to shut off the gas to the house?
I'm going to make some general statements, and then I'm going to let you folks talk about it, because it depends. That's my favorite word, and probably be my newest brand of underwear here one of these days. another decade, huh, Rachel? It depends on what the situation is. You want to, we were talking about that today. Boise, Idaho had a fire years ago. Everybody in the foothills turned on their sprinkler system, their lawn watering system, and I'm not sure why. And then the rest, you know, then they got up there on the roof with a garden hose, a lot of them. And when the fire finally was contained, they went up to the water storage, and this is about how much they had left. So, you know, that depleted a lot of water that could have been valuable for engines. So.
Scott, you want to handle that?
I concur with that. In fact, on the Madison Fire, we had a couple residents that did that. They put their sprinkler systems on, and you have the anticipation that you're going to be able, through your sprinkler system, protect your home. The reality of, quite frankly, is what we find, if it's a topography and fuel-driven fire, you're not going to get that strong ember fallout. And so sprinklers really don't make a big difference. And on the same respect, if it's a wind-driven event, the embers are going to penetrate your home. And once again, sprinklers don't make a big difference. And taking the advice of hardening your structure from the inside out, removing fuels, preventing ember from entering your structure, and then allowing the firefighters to use solid streamlines to put out spot fires around your home, that's the best thing to do. Keep in mind, in Monrovia, we're a reservoir-driven water system. If we have a large event, we will have limited water. And so that is a concern. If every resident were to put on their domestic water system, that would impact firefighting operations. And I would prefer to have the firefighters have access to the water than have every resident run their lawn sprinklers or shoot a small mist of water towards their home, which really won't stop ember penetration.
Yes. Hang on, let's go. I'm sorry, go ahead. How is your gas configured around here? Is it, are you talking about propane tanks? Is that, no, you're talking about, you're just talking about your natural gas. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess the same goes, you know, I'd switch gears a bit. In an earthquake situation, we train to turn off the gas because we're concerned about severed gas lines. In a fire, not so much. If you think about the gas supply to your home, unless you have an open source, you're not going to have gas running and burning necessarily. And so I don't know of any cases in which gas, open gas, natural gas caused a fire during an urban interface structure fire. I've heard a lot during earthquakes. And so in that preparedness point, we teach turning off your gas during an earthquake because you have broken gas lines. But not that I haven't heard of it during a wildland fire. But certainly we'll do some more looking into that and researching.
For the most part, and we had this discussion today, you know, one of the folks, Susie, asked about when she evacuated, she was curious about what to do with her small propane tanks. And we agreed that probably the best thing to do with those things is, if she doesn't have a place that's secure for them, is to put them out on the drive away from fuels, you know, because I know I've heard the story of people that keep those in their garage, and when the structure ignites, that's when those become, or in a shed ignites, that's when those become dangerous, because that long-term radiant heat expands the gas in there. They vent through their relief valve, and now they ignite. And in this particular garage, they didn't know how many were in there. Because they start flying through the air and through the walls, and turned out there were six of them there. But it took them a while to figure that out. And that was a dangerous situation. Yes, ma'am.
When we moved here 15 years ago, a firefighter came to our house and kind of gave us a tips on what to do about movement, cutting brush away, cutting down the junipers. And he also said that we're overdue for fire in Monrovia. And so what does it mean when they say, oh, this area hasn't had fire in years or so? Does it mean that is naturally always going to happen, like that is a prediction, or that there is, that it won't necessarily happen?
Well, I'm trying to think where this was, but this is Tom's story. You need to tell the story about your Australia trip, right? What'd they tell you in Australia?
They said that native California chaparral is the most combustible ecosystem in the world.
But they said at first, they said, you know, our eucalyptus forests are the second most combustible fuel in the world. And Tom's thinking, oh, wow. And then they went on to say that, yeah, the most combustible is Southern California.
Yeah.
So, you know,
they said that 1 acre of fully grown chaparral chaparral is equal to 10,000 gallons of gasoline.
Oh.
So.
Aussies love to quote these.
You know, I don't know if I'd take that to the bank if I were you, but you know, the fact is that you are living in definitely the most volatile fire area in North America, if not the world. That's just the fuel, the climate. That's you know, before this was a civilized section of the country, it happened regularly on a very violent basis, and with some fuel types, that's natural. We remember what happened in Yellowstone in the late 80s. You know, those fires went completely through those trees, and unlike the picture I showed you of ponderosa pine, where that was not would not have been naturally appropriate for ponderosa pine, for lodgepole pine and jack pine in the Great Lakes State, that's naturally appropriate. That's the way that ecosystem replenishes itself every 200 or 300 years. Down here, the chaparral cycles and those that are fire dependent, and what I mean fire dependent is that's how those species return nutrients to the soil, and when we take that element out, that interval out, what we find is that they are past their interval when they would normally burn. And so I think that's what they were getting at. You know, we would have fires on a 50-year rotation down here. We haven't had them for 150 years, so when they do burn, it's going to be exciting. But you don't want to be there, or you want to be prepared.
Yeah, exciting is probably the wrong word to use from our perspective. Here's what I'll do is I'll cite, there was a radio report on KPCC public radio following our Madison Fire incident. And what they did is they interviewed a earth scientist out of Pomona College, and he specifically cited Monrovia Peak. He said the last time Monrovia Peak burned was about 96 years ago. And his words were, we have a carpet bomb about ready to go off. Now, I'm not looking to suggest that we understand we have a threat here. I'm not looking to have pandemonia and have our residents concerned about that. We in Monrovia take fire protection, brush clearance very, very serious. Every year we go up there and we do brush compliance inspections. We have a 200-foot requirement, which is twice the state average mandate. Everywhere else in the state, it's anywhere from 30 to 100 feet. Every year, we get 100% compliance from our residents. We continue this education piece on how to prepare for the eventuality of a brush fire through hardening the structures, the Ready, Set, Go program, aggressive brush abatement. Those efforts really make a difference. And they better prepare our community for the inevitable that we will have more fires in the Southern California region. I can't tell you when it's going to happen. It could be a month from now, a year from now, 10 years from now. But Monrovia or the Foothill communities more than likely will see another urban interface fire. To me, what that is a motivator for our residents to continue to collaborate in taking best management practices to prepare. And the motivation here is we had a fire in late April, which was uncharacteristic in terms of the season. It demonstrates that we are in new territory in terms of fuel moisture, as I mentioned early in tonight's program. We have anticipated high temperatures and some winds that are anticipated earlier than usual. All of this prepares us for in a potentially erratic fire season. So it's best for us to continue these efforts to prepare. I'm not necessarily thinking that we're going to have a carpet bomb go off, but if we have a fire, which is natural from the ecology perspective, fire is good, and then it clears all that growth that's been growing for 150 years and provides a new regrowth. And we have a slide at the end here that shows the Canyon Park incident 3 years ago that has some new regrowth popping up that shows what fire does, and it's healthy. The real concern is that we understand that we have residents that are living in that urban interface, and we want to provide the best protection for you.
Chris, as
Sure.
Is it possible to control burns on, you know, high humidity, cooler days in the winter?
Yeah, the question is controlled burns, and is it possible to control the burns? Professionally speaking, there's no such thing as a controlled burn. I'm not a proponent of putting fire on the ground intentionally. I can cite a half dozen incidences where a training or control burn got out of control. The biggest was in Magic Mountain area, where a control burn led to about a week-long conflagration. And, you know, from a paper on pencil perspective of removing fuels away from the structure, it makes sense, but the risks to me outweigh the gains. So we then look at what else can we do? Brush abatement around the homes, potential buffer zone protections in those high-risk areas, removing the non-native vegetation in our wilderness preserve, making sure that we have good brush clearance along private and public right-of-ways, and then preparing for if a fire does occur.
Keep in mind, what I'd like to add to that is that, as we mentioned, it's not a geographical location, it's a set of conditions. And we've seen these situations that haven't been related so much to the wildland component. We saw a chimney fire on February 14th a couple years ago in Washington State that burned 20 homes, because the wind was blowing 50 miles an hour. And if you have conditions, volatile conditions and fuels around homes, it really doesn't matter if it was a wildfire or something else. Or was it San Bruno a few years ago had a natural gas leak and they lost 20, 25 homes? Well, you know, unless that component is there for house-to-house ignition, you know, if it's there, that's what you're gonna get. And so you're not, you know, you're doing this for reasons beyond just wildfire ignitions. You know, it could be the neighbor kids and model rockets, or years ago, you can't make this stuff up, okay? A couple years ago outside of Reno, a couple teenage boys were dipping lizards in gasoline and lighting them. And that burned the hillside in a number of homes. So you just have to be prepared for whatever it is, because on the worst possible day, there is going to be an ignition. If it's not a power line from a wind or if it's not equipment related, we have social misfits that are waiting for that day. Yes?
That fire gel that you can get to spray on your home, I don't know if you're familiar with
it. Oh, yeah.
Is it worth anything?
I'm going to let the chiefs talk about that, but I'll give you a distorted personal opinion first, okay? I want to qualify it. I thought for a while in my house that was my answer. You know, it wasn't gel, it was foam. And I was going to get a foam unit that I could use with its self-contained water supply. It was going to be a gasoline-powered pump, and I was going to foam my house and the neighbor's house. It was going to be like the old days, minus the overtime, of course, but I was going to feel, you know, like I was fighting fire again, until I realized one thing. What do you think that was?
Wind?
No.
Not enough time?
No.
How long
it
lasts?
No. I'm not going to be home.
Oh!
I have to be home. That's, yes, that's, well, there are technologies now that will do that.
Right.
You know, and people are selling those systems with water tanks, you know, 60,000 gallon water tanks, sensors and a sprinkler system around that will activate diesel generators that will power it. The question you got to ask yourself is, you know, we have sprinklers and we've taken the structural fire component off the list of these guys' things to do. How often do you respond, what percentage of the time do you respond to structural fires, Chief?
We're like most municipal fire departments, and 85% of our calls are medical aid. 15% are categorized as structure fires, floods, gasoline leaks. Of that 15%, probably less than 2% are actual working fires. And of those are usually room and contents that are handled by the first alarm assignment. So it's a fairly small percentage of calls that are large enough fires that cause multiple agencies to have to roll in. That said, we prepare for the worst, and we always take the proper actions to respond effectively, quickly, and to put out the fire as best we can. That's why we maintain the staffing levels that we do, because we never know when that call will come.
And the reason I ask that question is because we've managed to take this problem and reduce this hazard on a structural in the built communities. And we can do it in the wildland communities and those homes. We're just behind on that. And that's where they're trying to go. And the other answer about gels is, personally, I consider them a sleep aid. If you buy that and put it in your garage, you're going to sleep better. Are you going to be home to use it? Are you going to have the water pressure to make it work? Do you really want your husband, son, whatever, staying to use that? And we've seen a lot of cases where people will make that investment, put it in their garage, and their mentality is, well, now I don't have to do any cleanup. And, you know, my advice is if you have those things, again, like the propane, set it out on the driveway. When these guys show up, if it's going to work for them, let them be the ones. You know, leave that to the professionals. Do you guys use, you use foam?
Yeah.
Do you use gel as well?
No.
We carry foam with us. And if we have the Madison Fire, is a good example. I don't believe we had to use any foam. We were able to do it with water. But all of our apparatus carry special foam, and we could actually foam down the home in advance. It sticks to the side of the house, and it provides the protection needed. So that's one of the products that we carry in the fire apparatus. To be honest with you, though, we don't have enough foam to cover every single home in a fire region. We pick homes that are the most threatened and that we feel would have the most chance of survivability if we were to apply foam. That said, getting back to these principles of building your defensible space from the house out, if you do a good job of that, foam really becomes a moot point, and that you won't need foam or gel or some other type of agent. I just would be cautious in letting you know, you're thinking in the best case scenario of applying this product, and believe me, a fire is the worst set of circumstances. Anything that can go wrong will go wrong. You won't have enough water pressure. You won't have enough time. You won't adequately apply all the foam to the house or gel to the house. And I would rather have our residents prepare, get ready to go and evacuate and let the professionals go on up in there. And that's what we get trained to and paid to do, is to provide for protection of your home as opposed to you. And that would be my advice.
I would agree with that. The best thing you can do, you're best served by reducing those hazards around your home and in your subdivisions, so it's safe for these folks to get up there and respond with whatever tool works best for them. Yes, next. Yes, sir.
So we have kind of a catch-22. We're just about to start abating the brush. We have this mysterious gardener that starts a fire while he's abating brush. What kind of training do we have? So we never know what it was. Did the guy spill fuel while he's refueling the chainsaw, or was he using a wire instead of nylon on the string? What was he doing?
On the Madison Fire?
Yeah. On the Madison Fire.
A question on the Madison Fire. We are still under investigation. We actually have an arson investigator that came from a neighboring jurisdiction who is completing a full-blown cause and origin investigation. They're interviewing the gardener, the homeowner, the rental company in which the device was rented. They're looking to make sure that all proper safety procedures were in place, and I don't have an answer for you now.
Well, it was kind of a building question, in that it would seem to me that if the fire department would prepare a poster of some sort,
sure,
it could be posted at all the maintenance yards that the gardeners have their lawnmower sharpened at, because I don't know that they have any training at all. So we're bringing them into our property, and then they're starting a fire, and no one goes out in that profession and deliberately starts a fire. The gardener does not go out and deliberately set a fire. Is there any training program or information program that would aim directly at them? And if so, could that be accelerated right now? Because we're just about to start hiring these guys to do the work.
It's a great question. What we did is on our website right now, we put on there a list in both English and Spanish of gardening tips, how to do that to resist fire when you're doing that. You can print those out, and our suggestion is you print them out, hand them to your gardener, and say, here's a list of all the things you can do to help prevent fire when you're doing your brush mitigation. So we have that list posted on our website now. I believe it was on the front page of the city's website, the link to it. But if you go on the front page, you'll be able to get to our COPP component, and you'll see it on there. And I would encourage you to print those out and hand them out. And hand them out to gardeners or anybody who's working on your home. It's a great suggestion. We have that going.
It's also the yellow sheet that everybody's got.
Oh, thank you. It's in your handout tonight too, actually, in the yellow sheet. She's ahead of me here. So.
You know, we had this discussion today out in the field, and really came up with that is you're right. There needs to be some education here, and the question becomes, where is that knowledge coming from? And we've seen it come from homeowners. I mean, in a lot of I'm not a customer of these folks, but if you're paying them, and there's things, Susie has them work on specific things when they come out. She directs them to her hazards. She knows where her hazards are. She knows how they need to be treated, and she directs them to do that. And so that's how the knowledge is going. So. You know, I'm about ready to wrap this up, so if there's any more questions for me, yes, sir?
One more, speaking of power lines. This happened a few years ago. We live in an older neighborhood, North Monrovia. The original power lines have only a certain gauge. As everybody has increased their house size, their amp size, the lines have not been upgraded in our neighborhood. There was a draw 3 summers ago. It burnt the line. I happened to be at home. I was in my work boots. I heard this firecracker popping. The line had melted. We started a fire in our backyard on the low grasses. I luckily happened to get to the hose in town because it was slowly starting to go up to the dead palm fronds to burn the house. When the guys replaced it in Southern California Edison, I assumed they knew what they were doing. They used the same identical gauge of wire that burnt. 2 weeks later, neighbors come knocking at our door. There's a fire in your backyard. So I'm looking, he got to be crazy. I just put it out 2 weeks ago. There was a second fire because the guys from the utility company used the same gauge wire, because when I went the following time to inspect, I made sure they upgraded wire.
Well, that's not being an electrical expert, and that kind of falls on the last issue. You know, I know in California, you have representatives from major power companies on the board of fire safe councils, and they're learning this information too. I'll have to turn that one over to the local folks.
That's the local utility, uh-huh. And it actually goes to state. There's a Public Utility Commission, the PUC, that oversees. Okay. Edison. In our area, it's Edison.
To give you two guys a heads up, because this is going to affect you, which affects us.
Sure.
So if they're not doing their work, and it happened in my neighborhood, and I was a witness to it because it was in my backyard, I happened to be lucky at home to put it out.
Right.
Otherwise, okay, thanks.
Okay. Yes.
Just as one other issue, and there is a small handout out there for this fire. How many homes did we evacuate, Ben Turth?
500.
Of that 500, there were 10 animals that came to the evacuation site for animal evacuation. None of them had evacuation plans. Rachel alluded to it as part of the Ready, Set, Go process. Please make a plan for the evacuation of any animals that you have. That is critical and very important to know a place to take them. Have that in your plan. Have all the materials you need for them, including a picture of yourself with your pet, so that when you go back to reclaim it, you probably don't have any proof of ownership. So that's a real important component to have as part of your plan.
Yeah, that's totally appropriate, and thank you for sharing that. Yes, sir, did you?
Yes, I do. I have a number of buildings with attic vents, and I'm concerned about embers getting sucked into the vents. Is there any kind of passive system or anything that I could do to the vents that would prevent the embers from getting sucked in?
Yes, do you have, are you worried about under-eave vents, or are you worried about turbine vents, or what's
no,
your...
On the side of the walls.
The gable end vents on a vertical wall?
On a stuccoed wall where it's...
There are companies that are making ember-resistant vents. They've been approved by the fire marshal. There's a list of them on the fire marshal's website, which ones have been approved. They're designed to retrofit, you know, standard vents, and yes, they are ember restricting. Now, keep in mind, the scientists tell me a couple things that are worth mentioning. They say, because they play these little games in the lab and they with fans and embers, and they try and drive them through vents, and they first thing they say is, we can always get embers through vents. The size of the screening is huge, because at some point in time you get the screening so small you reduce the airflow, and now you're compromising what you need on a daily basis for an event that may be next month, maybe 10 years. So you've got to find some middle ground here. But they do, and the other thing they tell me is that the vents that are most susceptible are the ones that are going to be hit by the wind at a 90-degree angle. And so what they're saying is, under events, if you have them, need to be an eighth of an inch or smaller, as a screening. An eighth of an inch really is not small enough. So those, unless you have a bush under that that's going to put embers directly there, they're not as much at risk normally as the big gable end vents on the peaks of your eaves. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. I hope you go out of here tonight realizing that that this is a solvable problem. This is something to be concerned about. This is something to walk around your home, look at what might be problematic. You're fortunate, again, like I say, to have these folks here to help you point those things out. I've heard from a lot of folks that assess hazards like I do, that most people are worried about the wrong thing. So it doesn't hurt to get a technical expert out there to tell you how. And a lot of this stuff is small fixes. A lot of it's yard work, a little trimming, a little maintenance, a little watering. But it's going to make a huge difference, and it might make the difference between whether these folks are going to come up your drive in a severe event and take action on your structure. It might make the difference whether it survives or not. So anyway, think positive. It's a solvable problem. Go ahead and make a difference, and thanks for coming, and help educate your neighbors, please.
Thanks, Matt. Thank you. My name is Scott Haverly. I work as a deputy chief for the fire department. And one of the things I really like about Pat's presentations, I haven't heard a few of them now over the last couple of years, is that he makes the problem, he identifies the problem very clearly. So there's no question about our concern here with fire. But then he gives you, quite simply, some simple mitigation strategies in order to employ to make yourself safer and do that. And when I listen to his presentation, I always think about the fact we live in California, and the other big issue we constantly work with are earthquakes. Okay, now if you think back over time, we didn't bolt houses down in the past, but we do that now. I'm sure a lot of you, if you don't, we'll talk about that later, have 3 days of water supply or 5 days of water and food in your house. And you've changed your behavior, you've changed the paradigm shift to how you handle that. And it's simple. Some people have wrenches hanging on their natural gas now for earthquakes to shut off. They have plans ahead of time. Maybe you bolt down your large bookcases so they don't fall over anymore. And you've seen a dramatic reduction in damage to people and things that were minor injuries during earthquakes in California than we had, the Sylmar earthquake in the early 70s. And so it's just been a simple paradigm shift. It's taken some time, but it's no different than what Pat's talking about tonight. You live in the wildland, and there's things that we can do to mitigate this and make it safer so you can still enjoy where you live. And it's just why you moved up there to begin with, because this is a beautiful place to live and a great community. And so that's why you went there, and now we can help it make it a little safer and to make it stand by itself, just like you can your favorite bookcase, your china and tea set that you've got, you know, with braces, or you have something connected to it to hold it from an earthquake. And again, if you don't, we'll talk about that later, okay, afterwards. So in this presentation, what we want to talk about now is we want to get your input. In this public process, we've had a lot of collaboration with the community, and we've gotten some incredible ideas from everyone, people like yourselves, about how we move forward in our mitigation efforts and our education efforts. So tonight what we're going to do is we're going to set up three easels. We're going to take a few minutes and allow you to come up, stretch your legs a little bit, and give us your ideas and suggestions about three main areas. We want to focus heavily on how Monrovians can make their house more resistive to wildfire. But more specifically, we really want to talk about what are your chief concerns about your home that we should be addressing in this plan. And then we want to talk about obstacles. What do you think are some things that are getting in the way of people hardening their homes? Some of the things that are getting in the way of them getting this done. And then talk about a little bit about some motivation strategies, some ideas you might have of how we could help motivate people to further kind of work with this and further work towards this structural ignitability issue. And so what we're going to do is we're going to set up just three of these areas. Feel free to walk up and just give some ideas, and we'll jot them down on the sheet. And then we'll take those, incorporate those in our community wildfire plan. If you're like me, sometimes an hour later you're going to think of a great idea on the way home. Don't worry about that. You can send us an email at any time. There's a form there that you can actually fill out and mail in, drop off, whatever medium you'd like to use to get it to us. You can call our office if you'd like, call the fire department to discuss it. So anyway, don't worry about it today. You don't have to have the perfect answer right now. If you think about it in a couple of days, give us a call and we'll include it in there, okay? So we're gonna set these up right now and then everybody can come up.
Yeah, and just a reminder, once we complete this public participation, we'll end that process, and then we'll conclude this with public comment. So you'll have an opportunity, if you'd like, to come to the podium and provide additional public comment.
You know, Pat's still here too, if you want to grab Pat with any other questions.
Yes.
Okay, folks, we're wrapping up this public participation exercise, and it seems to me like we've gotten some good feedback from you, and we thank you. As Chief Haverly mentioned, if there are other items that come to you on your way home, tonight, tomorrow, please capture those in the public comment forms and send those back to us. You can also email those to us, and I'll give you a couple of follow-up emails here. The city website at www.cityofmonrovia.org, where you can provide or receive additional information and updated information. The written comments in those forms can be emailed to that email address, or they can be sent to Rachel Wing's attention, and you can certainly call us as well. And we look forward to your continued participation in comments, ideas, input. As I mentioned, this is the time and place for public comment. For anything not on the agenda or any other items that are of concern, I will open it up to those in the audience to come up to the podium and provide public comment. Okay, hearing and seeing nobody's interest in coming to the podium, I'll close that. And just a reminder that, as I mentioned, this is the picture of an area at Kenyon Park. We had a fire there, about 3-acre fire, that burned pretty substantially on the ridge. And this is a recent picture of the regrowth that's occurring. So fire is a natural ecological process. We understand that component of it, but we also take the fact that we have residents that are living in the very high fire hazard zone, and we want to provide the best possible fire protection through best management practices that we're identifying in this process. So once again, I thank you very much for your attendance.
Just quick question. Did you hydro seed after the fire?
No. This is natural growth, regrowth. We had a the sixth fire chief advisory group meeting scheduled for this Wednesday, but due to the fire that we had last week, we've postponed that. We will identify the new date of that meeting. And then subsequent to that, we'll be doing some neighborhood meetings that will be publicized. And then hopefully in the next couple of months, we'll be providing a draft of our community wildfire protection plan to be taken to City Council for final adoption. So there's still plenty of time to engage, to provide your input in, and to help us shape this document that really helps you help us. So thank you very much for being here this evening, and drive safe.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your job.